Build your house on a rock and the rains will come down. Build your house on a rock and the floods will come up. You've got to build your house on a rock. The winds will blow vehemently, but your house will stand strong. Whoa, strong. Whoever hears my word and he keeps them, oh yeah, whom shall I liken him to? He is like a man who built a house upon a rock, oh yeah, upon a solid rock. I do not choose to build upon the easy sands of life. I will take my time and build upon a rock. So build your house on a rock and the rains will come down. Build your house on a rock and the floods will come up. You've got to build your house on a rock. The winds will blow vehemently, but your house will stand strong. Whoa, strong. So be patient, my brother, he that hastens to be rich, oh, he has an evil eye. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Labor not to be rich. It is the blessing of the Lord that maketh rich, and not your effort. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and build your house on a rock and the rains will come down. Build your house on a rock and the floods will come up. You've got to build your house on a rock. The winds will blow vehemently, but your house will stand strong. Whoa, strong. There was a certain man, he had two sons. The younger said to him, give me my portion, I want to leave home now. And he began to have a lot of fun with many beautiful girls. Whoa. But one day there was a crisis. The young man lost everything and he had to feed the pigs. Nobody gave to him, his whole life was destroyed. So what are you gonna do when the rains come down? What are you gonna do when the floods come up? Tell me, what are you gonna do when the wind blows on you? Will your house stand strong? Say, build your house on a rock and the rains will come down. Build your house on a rock because the floods will come up. You need to build your house on a rock. The winds will blow vehemently, but your house will stand strong. forced to run.
Hallelujah. Father, thank you for this opportunity that we have today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I believe you have already received a lot this morning. I want to share with you on what I believe is the art of leadership. And I'm sharing with you from my book, The Art of Leadership, right here. Now, one of the things we need most in Africa is leadership. Do you think so or you don't think so? Only two people think so. Right. If we can settle down. The first thing in the art of leadership is choose hard and difficult things instead of nice and easy things. Amen. Choose hard and difficult things instead of nice and easy things. Amen. Now, many people do what is easy and nice. And that is why you are not able to lead and go forward. So nice and easy and hard and difficult. Always ask yourself, what I am doing, is it hard and difficult or is it nice and easy? You'll find out the things you need to do are the things that are hard and difficult. And the things that you don't really need to do. Not that you don't need to do, but they will not get you much results, are the things that are nice and easy for you to do. All right, you can look at the things you do as a leader and you'll discover that things that are nice and easy are usually the things that are not going to advance you very much. All right? The things that will take you forward. Let me give you 7 examples of hard and difficult things. Number 1, having a daily quiet time. Number 2, read your Bible every day. Number 3, pray for hours every day. Number 4, fast regularly. None of these are that easy to do. All right? I'll just put them all these 4 in one category. By the way, there's no need to write any notes because it's all in the book. I believe you all got the book. It's in the Macarius. I'm reading the book to you. So when you go, you'll understand the book better. Every book has what we call seals. And in Revelations chapter, I think it was 5, there was a great mourning in heaven because there was no one to remove the seal from the book. So a book sometimes needs to be unsealed or opened for you to understand better. That's how books are. That is why materials like this, the Makane, and some of these other products are very important because you get a chance to listen to preaching about things you are reading. Sometimes on the same thing. And it helps you to understand 100 times more what you are reading. Amen. So make sure you invest in both the preaching and the reading. They are both channels through which wisdom and knowledge are going to come to you. Can I have an amen? Now, Many, many pastors don't pray regularly and don't pray much, although we are pastors, and don't have regular quiet time. Some people listen to the radio in the morning. There's a lady who brought me up in Christ, and one of the things she taught me was quiet time. I dedicated the book to her. She's a wonderful Christian that I met when I was in secondary school. You know, and I can remember the day she sat down with me in the dining hall, and she said I should open my Bible, and she put a Bible here and then put a daily guide. Is it what we used to have, Scripture Union daily guide? And she said I should read this one, then after that I should read this one. We sat together. Read here. I finished reading. Now read here. Now pray. Now ask yourself, what have you learned? She taught me. And from that time, I began to have a daily time with God. Because I was not a Christian. I don't like traditional things which don't have meaning. So I didn't like going to church. I hated hymns, all those things. It was just dead and boring to me. That's why up to now, I don't know how to sing hymns. When they are singing hymns, I just watch them. My wife knows all hymns. She will be singing in the house, but I don't know any of the words. You know? So, I don't like dead things, boring things. So, I didn't find Christianity attractive. But when I found Christ in a real way, you know? Yes. Then, I was taught, talk to him every day. Pray every day. And that's what I learned. And it has become most of the revelations that I have had have come through my quiet time. Many times I'm preaching my quiet time. People don't know. It's the most important habit that I have discovered personally in my Christian life. So I can attribute many of the books I've written and many of the teachings that God has blessed me to have through this habit. And it's not that easy to have this quiet time every day. She also taught me another rule, NBNB. No Bible, no breakfast. NBNB, no Bible, no breakfast. You know, which, when you get a little older and you are not supposed to eat in the evening, becomes a problem because it made me not eat much in the mornings. If I've not read my Bible, I cannot eat. Hey! Is it a good habit? It's a very good habit. Are you here or are your minds on somewhere? Are you watching CNN as I'm preaching? NBNB. N for night or no. No Bible, no breakfast. Quiet time. It will make you stronger. One day, one of our pastors had a problem. And because of that, he was asked not to preach for some time. He started to backslide. Because he was used to reading the Bible only because he was going to preach. And because he was not preaching, he will have no reason to read the Bible. You see, that is a very dangerous thing. One day, I went to the house of a couple that were quarreling. Pastors can quarrel as much as members, even more. Because we are ordinary people. And they were having a marital argument or quarrel. Amongst them, included the children and all. So at a point, One of the children made a point and said, one of them, I don't want to say which one, the husband or the wife, they were both pastors, said that he or she, or he, she, he or she doesn't read the Bible unless he or she is going to preach. A child said it. My mother or my father doesn't read the Bible unless he or she is going to preach. The children have seen it. So I said, what does he or she do? And the child, who is also a he or she, said, he or she watches films. That's what he or she does. And he or she said it. So your Bible reading is not for preaching.
Thank you.
Your Bible reading is unrelated to what you are preaching per se. It always becomes related in the end. And that's why a lot of us are not strong and are not solid, you know. So quiet time every day, prayer every day, prayer. Yonggi Cho has taught me the art of waking up to pray. The last time I was in Korea, I was sitting with him at a dinner table, and I asked him whether he's almost 80, whether he still gets up at 3. And one of his associates, a businessman, said, hey, he's still doing it all. And he told me that he doesn't just get up to pray. He gets up and changes into his going out clothes, like a suit or whatever, at 2 a.m. with shoes and everything. And he goes out of his room, his bedroom to whatever, to pray. Whilst you are in your room, as if a hippopotamus is dying, you are snoring. Hey! No wonder your ministry is not like David Yonggi Cho's ministry. Yes, there's a difference. You know? Today he changes. That one I didn't know. I didn't know he changed. I knew that he wakes up, but I didn't know that he changes. So when you do that, you see. But I didn't. One time we were at dinner. Around 8 o'clock, he just left. He had invited us to dinner. Whilst we were sitting with 8 o'clock, he left, so it's time for bedtime. Yes. So when I started to follow that pattern, 8 o'clock, from 8 o'clock to, it's over. So I've started not to like late programs. Unfortunately, sometimes you can. Because when you don't sleep early, you can never wake up. You are watching films at midnight. Rambo. You are watching Rambo. How can you get up to pray? So choose hard and difficult things, and you'll be surprised that your life and ministry will advance. Yes, and people will make comments like, the anointing on your life seems to have multiplied. Yes, you hear such things. You hear people will make comments that it seems your authority has greatly increased. And you will find certain things people will even notice. When you start to do things which are hard and difficult, instead of always doing what is easy for you. All of us have things that are hard for us. Some of you find it hard to smile. When I first became a pastor, my wife was trying to teach me how to smile. And sometimes when she's sitting in front, she'll still be signaling me to smile. She says, I'm too serious. Hey, Number six. And number five. Learn things that are new to you. Amen. Number six. Educate yourself by constantly reading books. All right? Educate yourself by constantly reading. A pastor must be constantly reading. That is why a gift of the Makarios should be the greatest gift to you. It should be the greatest gift. It's like, this is what I need. Because there are a wide range of subjects which you may have never read before. And you'll find out that these books are quite simple. Children are able to read them. One of the commonest remarks I've heard about my books is that I don't understand reading and books, but when I read a book, I can understand it. Yes. Many children listen to me preaching. Recently, a child like this, his school was changed from a far school to a near school, a school that's far away to a school that's near his house. So he was no longer going in a car for a long journey in the morning. And usually I'm on the radio early in the morning. And the child did not want to change schools because he said they were not hearing the radio. The morning radio, 1 hour driving in the car. He didn't want to change school because of that. Like this. This is a child is like this. And you are like this. And you are not listening to preaching. Amen. Tell somebody, I'm going to educate myself by reading. Amen. And for some of you, listening to preaching may be something foreign to your how you grew up. And I realize that we all grow up differently in Christ. So depending on how you grow up in Christ, some things are normal. Recently, I met a pastor who told me, he said, you are the person who made me know about quiet time. He has a nice big church. He said, I listen to the radio in the morning. This is what I do. But I never grew up with quiet time because I didn't go to Scripture Union. If you go to Scripture Union, that word quiet time, you hear it. Is it not true? Yeah. Some of you didn't go to Scripture Union. It's very dangerous. But he said, no, I didn't listen. So it's like he prays and he sees God in another way. So, of course, there may be other ways and there are other ways. But also when it comes to listening to preaching, you may grow up and never know how to listen to preaching. That's also something I have seen. And it's hard and difficult for you to learn how to expose yourself to preach, even how to get the preaching. Because if you want it, what we are sharing, if you want, you'll get it. This Makana, it will fit on your phone straight. It fits on your phone. Everything is there. And other things. You just learn how to use your phone for. Me, I use my phone mostly for listening to preaching. I can't answer too many what I cannot answer. I just leave it. After some time, if I am able to see, I answer. But I use it mostly for preaching. It's very loud. I didn't know it was so loud. It's very loud. The whole house is just with your phone. You're listening to preaching. But you see, you may not have grown up with it. But learn, do hard and difficult things rather than what is normal and easy for you. You'll find yourself advancing and advancing and advancing with huge steps. This is what I found. When I learned this thing, choose hard and difficult, not nice and easy. You will notice a change in your life which you can't relate to almost anything else. Because you keep on choosing what is hard and what is difficult. And all of us have things that are hard for us. I mean, it's just the reality. So, after this conference, categorize the things you do. You know, when you're a pastor, like let's say praying for the sick. If you take, let's say, this conference and then the night crusade and then a camp meeting and then what other type? Sunday service. And then a what? A convention. Where you pray. They are all different things. And for a minister, it may be even easier for you to preach at the crusade than a pastor's conference. Depending on how you are. When you stand in front of the, what are you going to tell them? Pastors. Pastors. You may find it difficult to do that. And you may find it more easy to preach at a crusade. But you may not also find it more difficult to preach at a crusade. That's true. In fact, there have been times where maybe I wasn't feeling a certain way, I prefer to start praying for the sick than to preach. It's easier to be praying for the sick than to be preaching. And at times easier, and I will not tell you what is easier for me, whether the pastor's conference or the crusade or this or that. No, you should decide which one is easier for me. Which one do you think is easier for me? All of them look easy. They are not the same though. They are not the same. Yeah. But I can stay here with you till tonight. I don't have any stress at all. Yeah. I can be here with you till tonight. I don't even need to know what I'm going to talk about. I will stay with you till tonight. You will never be tired. Yeah. Huh? Depends on how you see it. So start to do the difficult part of your ministry. The difficult part. I can sit with the group 8, 10. We will be together till the evening. I'll never be tired. Once it's a type of people. I'll talk with you till night. But some of you, your top 8 leaders, you can't stay with them for long. You can't say, when you see them, it's like you are nervous. You have to have your agenda. Number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, number 8. It's time for closing prayer and then item 13. Is it what they call it, item 13? To go and eat something. Yeah. So, decide to do what is hard and difficult. And your ministry is going to catapult. You people, do you believe in having a greater ministry? Yes. Only on this side they are believing. And this section are not actually believing. Amen. Now, that is the first thing on hard and difficult. The next chapter is readily embrace new ideas. Amen. New ideas. All right. Now, Isaiah 60, 43, verse 19. Behold, I will do a new thing. Amen. After this conference, expect new things in your life and ministry. Amen. Especially if something keeps occurring to you. It's sometimes the Holy Spirit speaking to you. Now, one time I always remember this vision. Kenneth Hagin has had 8 visions of Jesus, 8 clear visions in his book, I Believe in Visions. It's a book I would recommend to everybody, especially all pastors. I Believe in Visions by Kenneth Hagin. I Believe in Visions by Kenneth Hagin. There are 8 visions. And it's almost all about the ministry. Now, at a point, I don't know whether it's in the book or one of his stories that he was telling, he said Jesus appeared to him and was talking to him. And then Jesus told him, you see, this whole week I have been telling you about something. And he was surprised Because he said that week, he had been thinking about something the whole week. So, but when the vision happened and Jesus spoke to him, Jesus told him that I have been speaking to you this whole week about something. So, what you don't realize is something that keeps coming to you and keeps coming to your mind and coming to your heart. The Bible tells us that the Spirit is crying within our hearts, Abba Father. But when he cries Abba Father, you don't hear it with your ears, Abba Father, although he's crying. You start to be conscious of the fact that God is your Father. That is how you hear the Spirit crying. That's the effect of the Holy Spirit crying in your heart, Abba Father. Are you listening to me? So when the Spirit is crying in your heart, get this message, get this book, read this message, humble yourself. You will see that it keeps coming to you. And so when Jesus appeared to Kenneth Hagin in the vision, Jesus said to him, the whole week I have been telling you about this. So make sure you open your heart to whatever God is telling you about. Amen. Five examples of new things that God does. Number one, God embarks on new projects, new schemes, new ideas. Behold, I will do a new thing, Isaiah 43. Number two, God gives new languages to his people. Number three, God gives brand new instructions. A new commandment I give to you. John 13:34. Number four, God makes us into brand new people. 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, and a man is in Christ, he's a new creature. So new person. And number five, God makes new agreements, and he issues fresh calls, in that he saith, a new covenant he hath made the first old. Amen. All right, so the chapter is entitled Readily Embrace New Ideas. Amen. Now, how many want to move forward in ministry? Move forward. Yeah. Be open to new ideas, new commandment, new instruction, new ways of doing things. I'll tell you that, you know, in Africa, we are not very creative. Is it true or not true? I think you should travel a bit more. I want to invite all of you to Accra next year to come to Give Thyself Holy Conference. I want to see you in Ghana. Come, all of you. The whole of, is it Kadoma? Which town is coming to? Kwekwe. The whole of Kwekwe are coming. Yeah. They said they are all coming. Kwekwe. Yeah, they are chartering a plane or whatever to come. So you are all invited. One of the reasons why we are stuck in the mud is that we refuse to think of a new way of attacking the old problem. Teaching. Amen. So we are stuck in the mud. Solidly stuck. I can tell you many times when I've been stuck and I pray. And in this book, A Good General, there's a chapter called Overcome Stalemates. You know, do you know what is a stalemate? It's like no one can win. You have to overcome it with a new idea. Years ago, our church was attacked. We were building our church building, the first building we ever had. And we were attacked by some people and the government at that time. So They came in the night to bulldoze down our walls. Soldiers came, all kinds of things. And we were attacked by the people. It was a whole funny thing. You know, and we had invested everything over there. You know, I recently heard Bishop Oyedepo say something. He said, no matter how much you have invested, God told him, he said, no matter how much you have invested in the wrong thing, when I speak to you, turn away from it and start to go in the other direction. He said, no matter how much you have invested in the wrong thing, when I speak to you, turn away from that thing and do what I tell you. No matter how much you have invested in the wrong thing. You see, that's what we call stuck in the mud.
Wow.
Now, that community, I said, this is the place we are going to be for the rest of our lives. Paradise. But it was broken down. It was destroyed. But it was still our church. I've never thought for 1 minute of moving from there. It had not occurred to me. Where would I move from? I said, this is a good place. I had even planned to expand down in this direction. Oh, wait, eastward it was? East.
You are teaching.
On the morning that our walls were broken, on that day, that evening, somebody came to me and told me there is a building, a warehouse belonging to a Lebanese man. It costs so and so million dollars. Something's millions of dollars. I said, millions of dollars? We don't have millions of dollars. Even $10,000 we don't have. It is here. If I would like to go and see. That Thursday, it was broken the Thursday morning. By the evening, I was forced to embrace a new idea. So I considered and I said, take me to that place and let me look at it in the night. And I went. That is what is called the Kodesh today.
Wow.
The first part of the Kodesh. Yeah. Most of my things they have been times that I've been forced to embrace a new idea. And no matter how much I've invested in that old thing, I have to open my heart and see what I can turn away from. It was the most difficult thing for me. My heart was broken. I was depressed for a long time. Because my whole ministry, I thought that was my ministry. I didn't know that God has given me a bigger ministry. I didn't know that. I thought it was everything. Hey, I didn't know that time will come, I will have almost 1,000 building projects. I thought this was the only building project we had. One and only. Yeah. Not 1,000, but almost getting to 1,000. Buildings, building projects. You know, then we wanted to build a campsite, you know, like a Bible school and a campsite. So we started. We bought the land. We built the foundations, several huge foundations. And a huge foundation for a huge hall on top of a mountain. And one day, a river came to cross the way that the cars pass to bring materials. So nobody could go there. And the government wouldn't make any bridge. There was no whatever. And we were stuck. Are you with me? So one day I said, you know what? We have another place at another mountain
which is a small place. Why don't we rethink about a new idea of something else? And we just want to do a Bible school. We want to just something small. We just want to have something small and just do the work of God. What are all these projects? And we moved up to where currently our Anakazu, I'll show you a video of it, you see. And we started, we were surrounded. There was a Rasta man here. There was another man here. Different people. Hey! We bought land from about more than 400 or 500 people. One piece. Little farms, small. In Ghana, we don't have farms like how you have these big farms. We have small. Everybody from here to here is my corn. From here to here is your cassava. From here to here is your whatever. Corn. And I move it. Up till today, that river is still at that place. And apart from the river, another group of people have come and said that land is for them. And they've come to make a wire fence in halfway through what we have built. And they are claiming that it is for them on all sides. But it is there. It is frozen. Up till today, it's frozen. Stuck in the mud. Behold, I do a new thing. A new commandment I give to you. They shall speak with new tongues. New ways. I give you a new heart. If you are always going to be in the same mood, you see, you see that at a point you cannot move. I'm telling you. And some years ago, something also came up in my ministry and my life, and I decided, out of the Kodesh, where we had already built this beautiful, I said, out. I'm going to the children. Yes. And by God's grace, we built another building that is as big as the Kodesh, virtually, and then I've moved there. And even the last Sunday I was there, something was occurring to me that this place is now too established. You know, I need more troubles to fight. Yes. Wow. Behold, I do a new thing. So many times you are stuck in your life and your ministry exactly at this point. When I started the church, I felt God wanted me to start a church. I did. But I didn't start it in the right way. And we started and we called the church Lighthouse. We called the church KCC, Kolebu Christian Center. No, and at the point, the Lord said the Kolebu Christian Center cannot explain your ministry at a point if it expands beyond Kolebu. Kolebu is the place. So I have to think of a new name. That's when I came with the name Lighthouse. And even the Lighthouse, God just recently led us, and I'm changing so many of the, doing so many changes. At a point, you may not even know which church it is. Oh, yes. You may say, which church is this? Unless you go further, you don't know which church it is. Wow. Behold, I do a new thing. Why are you struggling? Why are you struggling? That is why people get stuck. Look. Aeroplanes can only fly to a maximum of 700 kilometers per hour to 1,000. If you want to go faster, we have to do a new thing. Yes. So it's 6 hours to land. I have here 12 hours to London, 10 hours. 10 hours to London. Because the flights are all about 700, 800 when the plane is really going fast, it crosses 1,000 when the air is helping. But if it goes faster, the plane will break up. If you want to go faster, we need to do new things. And I'm sure one day they will say, we are going faster. If we can just introduce rocket science into the planes, it will be 1 hour to London. From Harare to London, 1 hour. You just leave at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, you are in London. Say, okay, hi guys, I'm here. Faster than from Harare to Bulawayo. But you see, the problem with that is that more planes are going to have to change than one, because you catch up with all the planes on the way. You'll overtake everybody. So if the Zimbabwe Airways is going at top speed, maybe South African Airways is using the old system. You pass all of them and on the way to London. 1 hour. Adolf Hitler had the idea to create rockets. He is the inventor. He is the one who brought rocket science, space, everything is from Hitler. Yes. He invented what they call the V rocket. And when the Second World War was, so London would be there, and they take off from Hamburg. 5 minutes later, it's bombing in London during the Second World War. It was the last, if the war had gone on a bit and they had been able to develop it, that would have been it. 6 minutes to London. From Germany to London, 6 minutes. Pow! Our church in London was bombed like that. Our church building that we own, half of it was bombed during the Second World War. Yes. So everybody will be in London. They're selling their, you know, pow! New idea. 6 minutes. Six. A new thing. When the Second World War was over, Americans came in and they were going straight for the man who had built the rockets. So they took him. They took about 100 of them, 100 of them, all Germans who were fighting, and took them to America and used them to build whatever. So when the Russians got there, they were late, but the Russians took the parts, all parts of rockets and things that were there, and they put it on a train and took it to Russia. And the Americans took the leader and the people, the human beings, and with all their plans to America, and they started the rocket thing. Yeah. Every war has been won by somebody who can invent something new. So as you keep on your very old way, it doesn't work. We have a formula for shepherding, PVCI. Recently, I came up with a new formula for shepherding, newer than PVCI. And it's working wonders for me. I see my church grow mightily with this new formula. Yeah. Behold, I do a new thing. Behold, I do a new thing. Behold, I do a new thing. Oh, I'm not getting your amens. I said, behold, I do a new thing. So open your heart to new things that God may want to show you that you haven't done before. One of the definitions of mental illness is to continue to do something that is not working and to continue doing it in spite of the fact that it's not working and continue and continue and continue. It's one of the definitions of madness. You will never be mad in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Tell somebody, I'm going to do something new because I believe God is giving me something new. Amen. All right. Now, the next, what was the first one that I gave you? Do what is hard and easy, hard and difficult, and then instead of what is nice and easy. Can we all stand up to our feet for a moment? Stand to our feet. Everybody stand up. New ways of having the meeting. You stand. Number three. Do you want to go out and wee-wee and come? Yes, I think so. I'm going to give you a wee-wee break. 5 minutes, please. Some people are even clapping for me. Democracy. All right. Some people want to go and wee-wee. I'm giving you 5 minutes because I keep people going in and out. So please, wee wee revolution, let's go now.
I received a call from God the other day. I was just a young person. He spoke to me and said, my child, you are mine. You must work and you must preach. Do you know the secret of prosperity? Seek ye first the kingdom of God. And all these things that people seek for, I will give them all to you. Go where I have to go, preach what I have to preach, have the maximum impact, yeah. I'll go where I have to go, preach what I have to preach, I will have the maximum impact, yeah. Blessed is the man whom God chooses, and he causes to approach. He shall be satisfied with the good of the house and of thy holy temple. Oh, one thing have I desired of the Lord, that one thing will I seek for, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord and behold the beauty of the Lord. Go where I have to go, preach what I have to preach, have the maximum impact, yeah. I'll go where I have to go, I'll preach what I have to preach, I will have the maximum impact, yeah. Do you know the secret of prosperity? Seek ye first the kingdom of God. And all these things people seek for, I will give them all to you. You shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless. He shall bless the bread you eat. He shall also bless the water that you drink. I am the Lord that healeth thee. You shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless. A blessing for all those who serve. He shall take away sickness from your midst. The number of your days he will fulfill. I will go where I have to go, and I'll preach what I have to preach. Whoa, whoa, whoa. I'll go where I have to go, preach what I have to preach, have the maximum impact, yeah. Go where I have to go, preach what I have to preach, I will have the maximum impact, yeah. Say, I'll go where I have to preach, then you'll have the maximum impact, yeah. I'll go. Stir it up, the gift of God, you must stir it up. Come on, brother, come on and stir it up. The gift of God, you must stir it up. Oh, it's been a long, long time since I called you when I chose you. Whoa, yeah. I placed my call upon your life. I gave you a gift, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now it's time for you to stir it up. Oh, yeah. The gift of God, you must stir it up. Come on, brother, come on and stir it up, oh yeah. The gift of God, you must stir it up. Oh, listen, can't you see? You're getting a little bit older. How long is it gonna take for you to see? And how much more time do you need to stir up the gift? You've got to use the gift God gave to you. Come on and stir it up, yeah. The gift of God, you must stir it up. Come on, sister, come on and stir it up, yeah. Gift of God, you must stir it up. Oh, oh, yeah. Do you remember how I called you when you were so young? You were so fresh and you were so excited. The gifts and callings, they are without repentance. If I make you a prophet, you will always be a prophet. Come on and stir it up. Yeah. The gift of God, you must stir it up. Come on, brother. Come on and stir it up. Oh, the gift of God, you must stir it up. Gift of God, you must stir it up. Come on, sister, come on, preacher, come on and stir it up, yeah. The gift of God, you must stir it up. You're my only God, and I want you to know, to serve you. If I live my life again, I'll choose you. It's been worth living for you. Lord, I love you, and there's no one above you, 'cause you gave your son, you gave your love, and you turned my life all around. You gave your life, you set me free. And so I serve you for the rest of my days. Oh, 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 oh. Ooh, ooh. Ooh, ooh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ooh, ooh. My Lord. Church, and I'll do it again and again, my Jesus, 'cause you gave your son, you gave your love, oh my, and you turned my life all around. You gave your life, you set me free, and so I'll serve you for the rest of my days. Whoa. Turn my life all around. You gave your life, you set me free, yeah. So I serve you for the rest of my days. Whoa, whoa.
Hallelujah. All right, all right, all right, all right. Value people. Value people. Now, two groups of people you must value: people above you and people below you. Below you or above you. Let me give you, many people don't know how valuable a person is, how important a person is. Ruth was very valuable in the Bible. Ruth chapter 4, verse 15, Bible says, "He shall be a restorer of life and a nourisher of thine old age. For thy daughter-in-law, which loveth thee, which is better to thee than 10 sons, than 7 sons, hath borne him." Amen. Better than seven sons, thy daughter-in-law, Ruth. You know? So Ruth is worth more than seven sons. That's the value of Ruth. She's the one who said, where you go, I will go. Where you die, I will die. Your people are my people. That's it. So a daughter-in-law can be worth more than seven sons. That's the value in the Bible. So people have different values. So you better watch out. Elkanah, 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 8. Then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why are you weeping? Why are you cast down? And why is thy heart grieved? Am I not better to thee than 10 sons? So there are some husbands that are better, more valuable than 10 sons. And there are some husbands that are not even as valuable as one son. Hey! Value. One day I called a group of sisters, all of them were married, and I told them, I'm going to ask a hard question. I said, if God was going to choose one person to take away, and you as the wife have to nominate, who will you nominate, your husband or one of your children? And some of their husbands were there. They were surprised that their wives nominated their husband to go. Hey! Huh? Yes. Their husbands were nominated. You go. Now, King David, 2 Samuel 18, verse 3, and the people answered, thou shalt not go forth. If we flee, they will not care for us. Neither if half of us die, they will not care. But now thou art worth 10,000 of us. So David was worth 10,000. Therefore, it is better that thou succor us out of the city. All right? Most people, all right, do not realize how valuable a person is. And that is something that greatly affects you in your life. Most pastors don't know how valuable people are. Number one, people, why you must value people? Number one, people are more valuable than money. To me, a person is more than money. There are people in my life and my ministry, they are worth more than million dollars to me. $1 million cannot replace them. Oh, yes. There are a number of people that are not worth $1 million to me. If you give me 1 million, take this person, take your million. I'll not even think about it. People are more valuable than buildings. Remember that Jesus did not build even one building. And he said, Father, I have finished the work that thou gavest me to do. The words that thou gavest me, I have given it to them. So people who you invest in are more valuable than buildings. I am sure Zimbabwe has a lot of buildings, houses with nobody living in them. Do you have that here? We have that in Ghana. A lot of houses. People who live abroad build houses. They don't ever come and stay. The building can be there, but it's nothing. The person who stays in the building is more important than the building. A building cannot do certain jobs.
But the person who lived in the building can create wealth for 1,000 people and jobs for 1,000 people. The house that he lives in cannot do that. People are more valuable than computers. People are more valuable than cars. Amen. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is important for you to value people. Why? If you don't value people, what happens is that you see, where you are not valued, you don't go there. You don't stay there. And you don't want to go there. And it doesn't take much to know that you are not valued. And what you are doing is not valued. It doesn't take long to you feel it. One day I went to preach somewhere. When I finished preaching, I got into the car. And when I closed the door, I said, I will never come here again. Yes. Nothing bad had happened. No word, no negative word had been said. Nothing bad had happened. It wasn't like maybe they had given me an offering. I was not happy. No, no, there was nothing like that. I just said, I will not come here again. I will not come here again. By the time I finished, I said to myself, these people have tolerated me. They have not enjoyed me and appreciated me. So when you don't value somebody, the person goes away. And I'm sure there are people that have gone away from Zimbabwe because their value was not known. And most people's value is known when, really known when they are gone. But for some people who have discerning eyes, you will know the value of a person when the person is there. And it's important to value somebody when the person is there. Now, it's important to value people below you. If I look at my ministry, I've got churches in America, in so many places. All those churches are part of us, so it's one body. Very valuable. Just one person who has a stable mind. The church is working. Hallelujah. That person is worth more than anything. But because you cannot train somebody and have a valuable and loyal person who will die as part of you, you don't have what is really valuable. Yes. You know, when we started having a Healing Jesus Crusade, we went to town where my wife comes from, and we had a crusade, a big crusade. We had two there. And my mother-in-law is a Methodist. She's deep in the Methodist church. She mentioned to me something that the people, the Methodist priests and some of the people had said, that if they have one of my Bishop Prince, one, the whole church would change if they had one person like that. Everything in their whole, they're just one person like that. He's the head of these things, crusade. If he had only one person like that. Outsiders, they didn't just, he was there working. He said, if we had just one person, you can do more. You can never do yourself. Almost, what do I do? I just came here, I preach, and I'm leaving. Somebody was here. I just came, as soon as I arrived, I came to preach. And I leave. Somebody. Very valuable. But you see, people don't value people. You know, especially young people. You know, because young people don't have money. You have to give them money even. We don't value them. That is why we don't have great people with us. There is hardly anybody around me whose wedding I did not officiate. What I mean by officiate their wedding means that I counseled them, I officiated their wedding, I was part of their life before even they became established to the point of getting married. But most pastors appreciate and value when a man comes to the church and he's selling curtain materials, or he sells carpets, or he's a top businessman. They say this is the second, third richest man in Africa or in Zimbabwe. This is the top director of this bank and this and that. And you say, he's here. This is a great person. There are pastors who have special ushers outside to signal when certain cars come to the church. I remember my wife went to a certain city in Ghana some years ago. I mean, it wasn't a strange thing. She arrived there. She had been traveling, so she was using a bigger, you know, bigger car for traveling. You know, she said the pastor was preaching. So she went to the church. So the pastor was preaching when she arrived. When she got out of her car, the pastor had left the sermon because he had been alerted that a big car has come to the church. He had been alerted that a big car has come. So the pastor left the pulpit and came out to meet her. Wow! These are what pastors value. And such people don't give much. People who you think are rich, they are the people who don't support the church. Oh. If you are not an experienced pastor, you will not know. Rich looking people and people who seem to be whatever, they are the people who give the least in a church. At least maybe in my church. I don't know about your church. Maybe your church is different. So you wonder why pastors have... We only value such people. Of course, you have to honor them, respect such people and all that. But you cannot live your life without knowing value of people. That's why some of us don't have branches. And we don't have people and networks. And we cannot expand. How can I do this crusade? We are in 15 cities in Zimbabwe. From town to town, I have enough people of a certain type to be ahead of me. They are there doing everything just as is being done here. When I arrive there, everything is set. Without people, you cannot, and as I'm here, so many, you can't see the people. Some are here, some are not here. I have more, I'm like an octopus with a lot of arms. Because you don't value them. He said, this one, he doesn't have money. Today, my church, you know, the other day we were having a camp meeting in a hall like this. And somebody came there and he thought there was no one there. Because there's no car on the car park. They don't have car, they don't have anything. I am with them all the time. I like them. They know that I love them. Children from school, all this one, a broken home, this, that, no different car. Thing, university, that, school fees, this, oh, these are my members. Oh. These are my members. Yeah. I'm excited. I preach every time I'm there. Yeah, I left the Kodesh, where the rich people are with this Oko. Stand up. I've left all the rich people for him over there. He's now the bishop of the rich people. Yeah, this one. And two other guys. And this one too. See, he's also here. Stand up. He's also there with them. Yeah. Bishops of rich people. And I'm with the children. The children of my pastors. Sit down. My pastor's children. My pastor's children. They are my members. My like his son,
his son and his daughter are my members. Last Sunday, the last meeting I had, his son was, I had a meeting, they were about 15 or 20 of them. His son was the one sitting in front of me. They are my directors. They are my bankers and my investors, and I'm the highest grade people. Yes, we're there when they were born. We dedicated them. That's why you don't have anybody. These ones, these children, they are in medical school. Yeah. Sometimes I get texts. This is Sandra using Anita's phone. Because Sandra doesn't have a phone. Do you understand? This is Sandra using Anita's phone. Long text, I listen, I think it's the other person. I said, oh, this is Sandra using, because my phone, I don't have a phone or whatever. So I'm using this phone to send you a message. And Anita get jealous that I replied Sandra's text on Anita's phone. No, not angry, but like, you are sending too many messages on my phone. It's my phone you are borrowing, and why are you sending more messages than me? That's why you don't have any valuable person. Ida, who is singing, she was a little girl in school when I saw her. I was sitting in the chair, who is that singing there, little one? Yeah, I said. I visited her when she was in school. She had nothing. She wanted to go abroad, and she couldn't even go. I told her, one day you go abroad, you'll be tired. You will cry. And one day she was abroad and she was crying. I said, why are you crying? She said, my baby, she wants to go home, her baby. I said, the prophecy was fulfilled. That's why you don't have anybody, because they are not valuable to you. A nation which persecutes rich people will only have poor people. A nation which doesn't publish the 100 richest and honor them, but rather the 100 richest and persecute them, follow them, investigate them, fight them. I met a man from Lebanon once. He told me, he said, any country which chases rich people out will only have purpose. Say, in Lebanon, they don't do that. That's why it's one of the, it is like the wealth place of Middle East at a point, Beirut, yeah. I don't know what you do here, but where I'm coming from, not easy to be rich. Hey. Investigations. One rich man can give 10,000 jobs to people.
Yeah. True.
Yes. One child can become, you can't imagine. That's why we send them, when we offer you a scholarship for Bible school, you send people, you'll be surprised. Actually, my mother-in-law, who is a teacher, says you can't tell what a child will become by just looking at the child. You cannot imagine this one is going to become something. Yeah. Mm. So value people, and they will grow up around you. Amen. And they will become... some of them, you see, some are going to marry kings. I tell you. Wow. And you'll be surprised that this little girl you took as your daughter is getting married to the so-so-and-so of such-and-such. Oh, yes. It is amazing. And one person somewhere can make all the difference for your life. Now, you must also value people that are above you. All right, you value people that are above you. You have to value your leaders. You have to value your president. You watch and see Zimbabwe with him and Zimbabwe without him. You may be surprised. Yes, you may be surprised. But if people don't value, they don't know what we have, they don't know what they have. Yes.
We had a president some years ago. I used to say, everybody thought I was crazy. I said, when this man goes, one day they will make statues for him. They will be calling for him. They will ask for him. Everybody didn't like him at that time. And I used to say that, and it has happened. Because people don't, they can't see it far. Then you must value pastors. If you don't value them, they sense it and they move away. Even your dogs and cats, you must value them. One day I bought a cat for my house because I had mice running in the ceiling. And I told my wife, the best way is for us to get a cat. So we got a cat. And when the cat came, people wanted to attack the cat. Hey, I said, no. When you attack this cat, he will run away from you. We need him to like us and love us. So you value him and her, and they will grow up. So they started as kittens, and one day they were grown up. And I said, come. And he came. And I held him in my hand like this. And I went to the ceiling, and I opened, and I put him in. He knew that I'll never do him any harm. I put him in, and I closed the ceiling, and I left him. That was the end of the rats. Yes. So I was able to use my cat. He never ran away from me. But I know cats. Nobody can catch it. My neighbors used to have cats. They had a certain man called Alaji who comes to kill them every year. He's the only one who, there are plenty. He brings a net and a stick to catch the cats. Yeah, he catches them with a net. Nope, you can't go near cats. So what you value, you handle it in a way, then it will come to you. If you value the anointed with his anointing, he will come towards you. Value. And that's why I'll teach you, value your pastors. Value them. Zimbabwe is blessed because of the pastors in Zimbabwe. I'm telling you, it's a beautiful and peaceful country because of the pastors and the churches. I don't know how to explain it to you, but it is so true. Zimbabwe is blessed because of the pastors. So value the pastors of your country. Honor them. Don't ridicule them. Don't insult them. Even those of us who are making mistakes, don't attack pastors. Amen. And God will bless you always through his servants. Look at Jesus Christ. He went to minister. Nobody listened to him. Bible says he could not heal anybody. Could not. Somebody who a few minutes later raised the dead after 4 days. Ah! Why was the anointing not working? The same person. He was not valued, not appreciated. They were rather questioning. So you, where is your father? Where is your mother? Where is this? Who do you come from? Is it not your brother? Were you not a carpenter? But we saw you selling coffins last Tuesday. We saw your Jesus coffin maker. You were selling coffins. You were making wardrobes. You were doing roofing chairs. How do you say you are the Son of God? Because we don't value, we don't get. Every man of God that God has introduced me to, I have valued greatly. They have felt that I value them more than almost anybody they have known. Oh yes. All of them. All of them. They know. One day, Yonggi Cho wrote a letter to me. I wrote to him about something. I wrote to him. And he wrote to me and said that, I will never forget what you have said. I will never. He said, and if there is ever any way I can ever repay you for what these words that you have spoken to me. Words. I'm not talking about offering. I offering is also there. That's different. But he said, for this thing, I will never forget you. And I will, if there's a way I can ever repay you. He said it. I can show you the letter. Most people don't value great. It's not a great person to you. It's not a great thing to you, that person. So what he's carrying cannot come to you. Like, that's why I treated my cat carefully, so that when I need him, he will come. When I got born again, the pastor, where I used to go to church, I value him. He says, he has said it more than we said that if it's only because of you, only because of you that I was a pastor, it is worth it. He has said it, means that all the church and all that, he said, nobody has only remembered me as you. There's none of my pastors in my church who behaves like you. Because these things are not valuable to you, it doesn't come to you. Ruth said, they said, David, you are worth more than 10,000 of us. There are people like that. Their value is very high in relation to you. So that's why I say to you, you will not know the value sometimes until there is death. And I'm sure our mama right here can tell us, explain everything I'm saying. Some of us don't appreciate our husbands. And some don't appreciate our wives. One day I saw a lady, I met her in a certain country. She said, when I see husband and wife arguing and bickering, it irritates me. I said, why? She said, because my husband died last year. And when I see living husbands and wives, always something. Yeah. Yeah, but I don't like this, I don't know what this, what, you know. It gets to me. She said, my husband was a pastor of a large church. We were a large church. And he had a tumor, yes. He said, he used to pass by in the house and, oh, he likes touching me. And I said, don't touch. She told me, I used to say, don't touch. Oh, I don't like when you touch me. I don't like when you touch me. She said, as he went on, he would lie down. He said, after the dedication of the church, that was the last thing he did. He came and lay down. She said, the time came, I would sit by him, and I would look at his hand, and I would say, oh, I wish you would lift his hand and touch me. What I used to complain about, I wish you would lift his hand to touch me. But he was no more lifting his hand. She said to me, when I see husbands and wives bickering, those were her words, arguing, talking, not happy with each other. It irritates me to the highest level. Yes. We don't value what we have till it's gone in a flash. Are you still here? You are leaving. Amen.